Meet person A and person B. Person A is a scientist, maybe a mathematician, an engineer. It doesn't matter. What matters is that it has a linear thinking. It believes in logic and facts to prove his point. Person B is an artist, maybe a painter, maybe a writer. It has big dreams. It follows its intuition and creativity. So I want to ask you a question. Do you consider yourselves more like person A or like person B? Come on, the ones that think that they're more like person A, raise your hands. A, scientist, okay. B, artists, okay, interesting. So I've seen that many of you haven't raised your hand. I hope it's not because you're shy, but maybe because you don't feel represented by those stereotypes, or maybe by both. Welcome to my life, person C, someone who swings between both science and arts. This is me when I was 5 years old. I was reading an amazingly interesting book called The Supermarket. Now I'm 19 years old, but nothing has really changed. So I could also show you a picture of me playing with Lego constructions, or maybe doing little experiments, or drawing. What I want to show you is that these are not faces. I have been into science, into maths, into biology, and I have been into arts, into writing, into reading, into drawing throughout my life. And as I grew up, I realized maybe there is something wrong with me. Because I saw the other kids, and they seemed so sure about themselves. There was this boy who was so creative. He drew super funny comic strips. And this girl was really smart. She was so good at maths. Why did they fit in one slot? Where did I belong to? So what I want to tell you is I want to ask you a question. Where do you think that this question comes from? Why do you think there is this big wall between science and arts? I want you that by the end of this speech, more of you think, oh, maybe I'm not a person A, maybe I'm not a person B, maybe I'm a person C. Okay, so I realized that there are three assumptions that people make. Three assumptions that people see, that's why the world is divided into scientist and artist. Number one, our brain is separated into logic and creativity. We have our scientist side, and we have our artistic side, right? Number two, we all have a dominant side of the brain. We are a scientist, or you are an artist. But you can go for both, and that's where our third is going. Art and science are not compatible. Okay, that's what people were telling me too. So I made a list of all the degrees when I had to choose a career. See, this is one of the pages. There were three pages, actually. I can tell you what's in there. All of the degrees that you can think of. Well, not all. I did not put medicine. I cannot handle blood. I'm sorry. So I started to painfully cross one after the other one. And I ended up going for human biology. That's what I'm doing now. I'm a second year student in UPF. This is a brain. And this is where our first assumption goes to. We said that we have a left hemisphere that it's about logic, about science. And we said there's this right hemisphere that it's about creativity, about arts. Can you see that I'm smiling while I'm saying it? That art is about so happy and science is so boring. This red thing, it's called the corpus callosum. In 1970s, a man named Roger Walcott Sperry studied it. Why? Why is it important? Well, because our brain is definitely divided into different areas because it needs to be productive. We cannot have all the brain doing the same thing. We have different areas doing different jobs, but we need it to be connected. We need it to talk to each other so we're working as a whole. And that's where the corpus callosum comes into play. We need it to be so well connected that what Dr. Sperry found out that was that when people had it cut, when they had no corpus callosum, they were not able to do some activities. And he traced them, and he realized, oh, in the left part of our brain, we have calculation and language together, calculation and language. And on the right side of our brain, we have spatial reasoning. Right there, he had just started the myth. Even though he said, be careful, what I've just said, it's very easy to run wild with. Be careful. It had just all started. Why? Well, a couple of days later, the New York Times published this article called two astonishingly different persons inhabit our head. Boom, Civil War, movie title, amazing. No, guys, this is us, all of it. We don't have two people working for the controls. Let me take over. No, let me take over. But then the article continued, we are left-brained or right-brained. And then they said, the left part of your brain is about logic. The right side of your brain is about creativity. See what they did? They did a small simplification. Yet by doing that, they made a huge mistake. It's not so simple. We cannot just say that our brain is divided into science and arts. And that's where our first assumption goes to the trash can. We cannot believe in that. Let's go for our second assumption. We said, I'm sorry, you're left-brained or right-brained, just like this article is saying it. I mean, you've probably seen tests online. Tests that will tell you, are you left-brained or right-brained? I took it, it said 60% left-brained, 40% right-brained. Great, yes. Well, not so simple, because this had never really been neuroscientifically proven until 2013, when a group in Utah studied over 1,000 brains for 2 years. And what they found out is that there was actually no basal predominance for one side, which means that we do not have a dominant side. We cannot use it as an excuse anymore. I'm sorry, if you're a scientist, you cannot just say, I'm sorry, my left brain is more like the dominant one, I cannot draw. No, this is not true. Our second assumption is not true. So let's go for a third assumption. We said they cannot be combined. Science and arts are different worlds. Well, I see that's exactly what they have in common, the world. The world is gorgeous, life is amazing, it's beautiful, yet it holds so many mysteries that we human, we cannot just sit there and watch. We have to communicate it, to express it, to show it, to understand it. If you do it through a brush, if you do a poem about it, or if you take the numbers to try to understand it, it doesn't matter. I can take a flower, and I can paint you a beautiful natura morta out of it. Or I can take your flower and do the Fibonacci number, which is a sequence of numbers that do patterns found in nature. It doesn't matter, we're all trying to understand the world. And you say, okay, Cèlia, see, I see what you did there. You just said it, there are different worlds, like there's different ways of expressing it. Well, no. Can you hear this song? This is the pi number. Yes, 3.1415. A YouTuber called A Song Scout took some of the numbers, put each one to a music note, then arranged something for the other hand. This is what came out of it. Is this science? Is this arts? What about this? This is not an abstract painting. This is our retina. This is what we're looking through. Oh, it's beautiful. So can you see that maybe science and arts are maybe more connected than what we think? Maybe they're not so different after all. Our third assumption was they cannot be combined, right? So what I want to tell you is that not only can they be combined, but by doing this, we actually get even greater results. I want to give you three examples. Number one, meet Isaac Asimov. He had some really cool beard. Yeah, you can laugh about it. It's really cool. But he was actually one of the greatest science fiction writers ever. If you haven't read anything about him, you definitely should. Maybe you have seen I, Robot, the movie? Well, it was inspired by a book he wrote. Star Wars, inspired by his work. What I'm trying to tell you is that he even got a prize for a trilogy that he worked in, Foundation. And that prize was created just to show how good he was. You've heard me. Like they said, this trilogy is so good, we have to make a prize just to show how good it is. That's amazing. You said, okay, great artist, yes, great writer. And I said, well, he was a biochemistry teacher. How does that work? Well, because it was just that what made him great. He was able to imagine a future using his scientific tools. He was able to imagine and say, oh, if this works now, maybe in 2 years, let's see what could happen. And then through his artistic skills, he was able to express it. And that's what made him so great, that he took both science and arts, infusing them. Let's go for our second example. Maria Sibylla Merian. This was a woman, now we're talking about the 17th century, and this was a woman who was mind blown. She was amazed by insects, especially by caterpillars. And now we're talking about a time when caterpillars were seen like the devil's creature. Why was she amazed by them? Because she looked and she said, How can something like that become such a beautiful butterfly? So she sat there, and she draw. She draw all the process. She just draw and draw. That was what Monet was doing, too. I mean, Monet was just looking at flowers, and he was painting them. Exactly, because that's what it's about. But by doing this, she was doing a science work. She was actually becoming a botanist. She was setting the basis for the entomology of insects. See, what she did, once again, was combine both arts and science. That's what made her an important figure. Let's go for a third example. You probably know him. We're talking about Antoni Gaudí. Gaudí, this is La Sagrada Familia. Gaudí is a scientist or is he an artist? Well, he's both. Because what he did is be amazed by nature once again. He actually said it, I'm not an original, I just go back to the origins. Because he was being amazed by nature, then with his scientific tools, express it. You can see columns in here. What I see is a forest. It's a forest of trees made of stone. That's what made him great. Once again, it's combining both science and art. Can you see it? Maybe there is not such a huge difference. And you'll tell me, okay, but you see what the problem is? Education is telling us more than ever that we have to choose science or art. I started talking about myself. I said how I ended up going for science. I went for human biology. Well, that's not entirely true. See, I'm still this 5 years old who still reads books. Not the supermarket, I read more interesting books now, but in my free time, I go to the theater, I read, I write. I even have a small YouTube channel where I talk about the two things that interest me the most, science and art. And now if you told me, Cèlia, if you were given the option to go back and choose a degree again, what would you do? I wouldn't change anything, because my greatest decision was not to choose. You can choose and be good at something. You cannot choose. Take everything you like, combine it, and be great. Thank you very much.